Many, many years ago, lived an emperor who thought so much of new clothes that he spent all his money in order to obtain them. His only ambition was to be always well-dressed and to cast a magnificent appearance to the world. He did not care for his soldiers, and the theater did not amuse him. He cared not for art, nor books, nor music. Words of counsel from his most learned advisors went unheeded. And since the affairs of state held no interest for him, he left those to others while he admired himself before his great crystal-looking glass.
Oh, I say, Chamberlain, this riding outfit must be the most stunning set in my entire wardrobe.
Indeed, Your Highness.
Yes. I would say that I truly cut a most dashing figure. Would you not agree?
Oh, without a doubt. Excellency, you once again displayed your unequaled taste as an example to all of us, your most humble subjects.
The emperor had a coat for every hour of the day, and as one would say of a king, he is in his council chamber. So one could say of him, the emperor is in his dressing room. It was said that the only thing he liked better than buying fine new garments was to travel across his realm and proudly display his new attire to any and all. And such was his utter devotion to his own appearance that it was the subject of much talk and conjecture across the land.
Do you know what I heard? I heard that the emperor will be going on another tour across the land to display his latest finery.
And it is said that he spent so long admiring himself before his great looking glass that he fell asleep standing up.
Now the great town where he resided was the destination for those seeking employment and fortune, and every day many strangers from all parts of the world arrived. One day, two swindlers came to this city and listened with sharp ears to the stories the town folk told of their emperor, and after a time, one said to the other,
I do believe I have a notion as how we might part this majestic one from a good bit of his treasure.
Ah, treasure, you say? Well, I am all ears, friend. Pray, tell me your idea.
And to a nearby tavern, they went and concocted their scheme.
It was not long before the news began to spread that there had arrived in the town two master weavers whose skills at the art of the cloth were unparalleled in the known world. It was said that their newly developed methods would soon cause them to be in high demand in the grandest houses and most esteemed in royal courts across the world.
I was told by someone I know in the court that these gentlemen are able to weave the most amazing cloth that is the finest in all of creation, with the most wonderful colors and patterns beyond imagination.
I have heard the same, friend, and not only that, but that the material possesses the wonderful quality of being invisible to any man who is not suited for his office or who is severely numbskulled.
Oh, I dare say that is most extraordinary indeed.
Before long, the news about these wonderful weavers, who in actuality were, of course, the two swindlers, reached the emperor.
That must be wonderful cloth,
thought the emperor.
If I were to be dressed in a suit made of this cloth, I would be the envy of all. Also, I'd be able to find out which officials in my empire were unfit for their positions, and I could distinguish the clever from the dull. I must have this cloth woven for me without delay."
And he summoned the swindlers that very day. They bowed low before him as he sat regally upon his throne.
"You, young fellows, are forthwith commanded to present me with a suit manufactured from your newly contrived cloth, which I hear is considered to be the finest in all the world."
"Your Excellency, we are most deeply honored by your most generous and condescending attention."
"Yes, Excellency, our hearts are near to bursting with gratitude at the faith you are placing in us."
And he gave a large sum of money to the swindlers in advance that they should set to work without any loss of time. They were led to a large workroom where there were two looms, and where they immediately pretended to go to work. To the chamberlain, the swindlers called out,
"You, sir, go at once and order a large quantity of the finest silk."
"And gold cloth."
"And gold cloth, and return with haste while we recalibrate these looms for our intricate purpose. Be lively now."
The chamberlain ran from the room in great haste and returned a short time later, laden with quantities of the finest and most expensive silks and gold cloth that could be found.
"What exceptional quality, good sir,"
said the swindler, running his hands over the precious material.
"These will do very well indeed."
"Yes, very well, sir. Now be off with you, so we can tend to our business,"
said the one to the Lord High Chamberlain as he hastily ushered him out and tightly closed the door. The two hummed contentedly to themselves as they stowed away the rich fabrics for their later travels and set about making such a clatter with the empty looms that all of those outside the doors marveled at the tremendous work they imagined was happening within.
"Listen to the tremendous effort being made. It must be difficult indeed to create this wondrous cloth."
"I am trembling with anticipation. I cannot wait to view the wonder of it."
Far into the night, the swindlers created an awe-inspiring din while producing nothing whatever on the looms except noise. At various hours, they asked for more of the finest silk and the most precious gold cloth, which they promptly stowed in their traveling chest and worked at the empty looms till nearly cockcrow. And in the town, everyone knew what a remarkable quality the material possessed, and all were anxious to see how incompetent or unintelligent their neighbors were. And they stayed up late into the night, speculating about who among them would be found out.
"I almost feel sorry for poor Jane. She's bound for great embarrassment when it is revealed how foolish she is."
"Not to mention the high sheriff. He holds himself so exalted in his position that it will come a great shock to him when all the town learns that he's not the man for the post."
Meanwhile, the emperor nervously paced in his bedchamber.
"I should very much like to know how they are getting on with the cloth,"
he thought, but he felt rather uneasy when he remembered that he who was not fit for his office or was extremely dull-witted would not be able to see it.
"Of course, I have nothing to fear. I am, after all, the emperor. Yet, I do believe it might be advisable to send someone else first to see how matters stand. I shall send my honest old minister to the weavers. He can judge best how the material looks, for he is intelligent and nobody understands his office better than he."
So the good old minister was summoned for the task, and he went into the room where the swindler sat working before the empty looms.
"Heaven save us,"
he thought to himself, opening his eyes wide.
"I cannot see anything at all, but in no way shall I say so."
Both swindlers requested him to come near to the empty looms to admire the wonderful fabric.
"Is it not exquisite, good sir, if I do say so myself?"
"Behold the vivid patterns and how the colors shimmer and shift before your eyes."
The poor old minister tried his very best, but he could see nothing, for there was nothing to be seen.
Oh dear,
he thought.
Can I be so incompetent, oh dim-witted? I should not have thought so, and nobody must know it. Is it possible that I am not fit for my office? No, no. I cannot say that I was unable to see your cloth.
What? Have you got nothing to say?
Said one of the swindlers, while he pretended to be busily weaving.
Oh, it is very lovely, exceedingly beautiful,
replied the old minister, looking through his glasses.
What exquisite pattern, what brilliant colors. I shall tell the emperor that I like the cloth very much.
We are pleased to hear that,
said one of the weavers, and then described to him the colors and explained the curious pattern. The old minister listened attentively that he might relate to the emperor what they said, and so he did. Now the swindlers asked for more money, silk, and gold cloth, which they required for weaving. They kept everything for themselves, of course, and not a thread came near the workspace, but they continued as hitherto to work with great vigor at the empty looms. Soon afterwards, the emperor sent another honest courier to the weavers to see how they were getting on.
Sirrah, take yourself to the weavers and make an inspection of their progress with the cloth. Ask if it is nearly finished and report back to me without delay.
At once, Your Excellency,
said the courier, and he ran to the weaving room. The man banged loudly on the door so as to be heard over the clattering of the looms.
But, sirs, the emperor wants to know how the cloth is coming along.
Well, why didn't you say so? Come in. Come in and see.
Like the old minister, the courier looked and looked, but could see nothing, as there was nothing to be seen.
Is it not a beautiful piece of cloth?
Asked one of the swindlers.
Consider the curious floral patterns and the vibrant shimmering colors,
said the other, of the cloth which did not exist.
I'm not stupid,
he thought.
It must therefore be that I'm not fit for my good appointment. It is very strange, but I must not let anyone know it, lest I lose my position.
And he praised the cloth which he did not see and expressed his joy at the beautiful colors and the fine patterns.
And I shall inform the emperor and testify to the supreme excellence of the fabric.
Then everyone in the whole town talked about the precious cloth. At last the emperor wished to see it himself, while it was still on the loom. With a number of courtiers, including the two who had already been there, he went to the two clever swindlers, who continued to work as hard as they could, but with only thin air instead of any thread.
Is it not magnificent?
Said the old minister, with booming confidence in his voice.
Your Majesty, behold the radiant colors and the delightful pattern,
joined in the courtier with great fervor. And then they pointed to the empty loom, for they imagined the others could see the cloth.
What is this?
He thought.
I do not see anything at all. This is terrible. Am I dull-witted? Am I unfit to be emperor? That would indeed be the most dreadful thing that could happen to me.
Really, my good sirs,
he said, turning to the weavers.
Your cloth has our most gracious approval.
And he nodded with seeming content as he looked at the empty loom, for he did not like to say that he saw nothing. But if all the others saw it, he considered it must be true. All his attendants who were with him looked and looked, and although they could not see anything more than the others, they each murmured their approval.
How completely beautiful.
What splendid workmanship.
Words cannot describe such a magnificent creation.
It makes me weep to behold this heavenly sight.
And all advised him to wear the new magnificent clothes at a great procession, which was soon to take place. Everyone seemed to be delighted with this suggestion, And, after a brief pause, the emperor agreed that this was a capital idea.
yes, certainly. A grand procession is just the thing.
He then cleared his throat and, with a sonorous tone, he gestured to the herald and made a ceremonious announcement.
It is with great pleasure that I do hereby appoint these two young men the Imperial Court Weavers.
Yeah!
The whole night previous to the day on which the procession was to take place, the swindlers pretended to work and burned more than 16 candles. People should see that they were busy to finish the emperor's new suit. They pretended to take the cloth from the loom and worked about in the air with big scissors and sewed with needles without thread and said at last,
"The emperor's new suit is ready now."
The emperor and all his barons then came to the hall. The swindlers held their arms up as if they held something in their hands and said,
"These are the trousers.
This is the coat.
And here's the cloak.
Now they're all as white as a cobweb, and one must feel as if one had nothing at all upon the body. But that's just the beauty of them."
"Indeed,"
said all the courtiers, but they could not see anything, for there was nothing to be seen.
"Does it please your majesty to graciously undress, that we may assist your majesty in putting on the new suit before the great looking glass?"
The emperor undressed, and the swindlers pretended to put the new suit upon him, one piece after another, and the emperor looked at himself in the glass from every side.
"How well they look,
how well they fit. What a beautiful ensemble, what fine colors.
Nowhere else in the world is such a magnificent suit of clothes."
And the emperor, while feeling disappointed that he could not enjoy what all the others were plainly seeing, he was gratified to be the object of so much admiration. The master of the ceremonies announced that the bearers of the canopy, which was to be carried in the procession, were ready.
"I too am ready,"
said the emperor.
"Does my suit not fit me marvelously?"
Then he turned once more to the looking glass so that people should think he was taking the moment to again admire his garments. The chamberlains who were to carry the train stretched their hands to the ground as if they lifted up the trailing remnant and pretended to hold something in their hands. They did not like people to know that they could not see or feel anything. And as the courtiers and attendants fluttered about in their preparations, no one noticed as the two swindlers bundled up all of their spoils and slipped out of town by the rear gate. When all was ready at the entrance to the castle, trumpets sounded and the emperor marched in the procession under the beautiful canopy, and all who saw him in the street and out of the windows exclaimed,
"Indeed, the emperor's new suit is incomparable.
What a long train he has. How well his regal garments fit him."
For you see, no one wished to let others know he saw nothing, for then that one would have been unfit for his or her station or considered most dull-witted. Never were an emperor's clothes more admired. But then, even as the crowd loudly murmured its approval, a small voice rang out above the din.
"But he has nothing on at all,"
cried a little child at the edge of the road.
"Good heavens, listen to the voice of an innocent child,"
said the father, and one whispered to the other what the child had said.
"Did you hear what she said?"
"Wait, what?"
"Nothing at all."
"What did she say?"
But he has nothing at all,
cried at last the whole people. Now that made a deep impression upon the emperor, for it seemed to him that they were right, and he stumbled a little as he walked. But he thought to himself,
"Now I must bear up to the end."
And in his pride, the emperor pressed on as though he'd heard nothing, with his head held high and his face as red as a ripe apple. And the chamberlains followed along with still greater dignity as they continued to carry the train, which did not exist.